I'm Dr. Vanessa Sinclair, and this is Rendering Unconscious. My guest today is Dr. Nathan Bell, professor at the University of Melbourne. His new book, Refugees, Towards a Politics of Responsibility, is available as a book and ebook from Roman and Littlefield. Links to his work can be found in the text accompanying this episode. Rendering Unconscious is also a book, Rendering Unconscious, Psychoanalytic Perspectives, Politics, and Poetry, available from Trapart Books, 2019. For more, please visit our publisher's website, trapart.net. That's TRAPART.net. You may also find this episode at YouTube at Trapart Film's YouTube channel. Just search for Trapart Film or Rendering Unconscious Podcast at YouTube. For more information, you can visit my website, drvanessasinclair.net, and sign up for my newsletter on the contact page to stay abreast of all upcoming events. You can also visit the Rendering Unconscious main website, renderingunconscious.org. And follow me at Instagram and Twitter at @rawsin_. That's RAWSIN_. Thank you so much for listening to Rendering Unconscious podcast and for your support. You can support the podcast at our Patreon. That's patreon.com/Vanessa23Carl. Your support is so appreciated. Thank you so much to all of our Patreon patrons.
Well, firstly, thank you, Vanessa, for having me on your podcast. Very glad to be here. In terms of where to start, I suppose I should start with my journey as to how I got to write this book, Refugees Towards the Politics of Responsibility. It grew out of my beautiful, nice hardcover copy there. It grew out of my PhD that I began many years ago, 2010, actually. I did it part-time because I was working at the same time. And I did that on the ethics of hospitality with a big focus, especially on Jacques Derrida. He talks a lot about the concept of hospitality and what he calls unconditional hospitality. And I thought that was a very interesting way into the question of asylum, to think about it through the lens of hospitality. And there was a particular phrase that he uses in his work that was the precise sort of exigency for my research, where he says that ethics is hospitality. And as a young undergraduate, younger than I am now, I was very struck by that phrase, saying, you know, what is this claim? Ethics is hospitality, that we can, that ethics is nothing but hospitality or is reducible to hospitality. What does this mean? I thought, wow, this is amazing. Ethics is hospitality. And I wanted to explore that claim. Now, a little older and wiser, I'm less impressed by that phrase. I actually find it a little trite. He's simply referring to the etymology of the word ethics, which refers back to ethos in terms of one's mode of dwelling. So that's really all he's doing when he says that ethics is hospitality. He's referring it back to that, its etymological root. But even so, it was an interesting provocation to me that sort of launched me on a path of exploring the problems and the limits around the politics of asylum. Why do states behave the way they do? What is the structure of the logic in terms of the arguments that are marshaled, especially around the right to exclude people? Because we could sort of take it as given that, you know, I accept the rubric of the arguments that are made that state borders are largely racist borders. Like as a friend of mine who works in refugee rescue on the Mediterranean puts it, that the distribution of life and death is often decided on the basis of the color line. You know, black and brown bodies are held to not count as much. So there is that sort of structural racism to borders and the policing of borders that goes on all around the world. So I address that in part in my book, but I also wanted to take it a little bit broader than that and come up with a more generalized concept of the political. And I wanted to place the right to asylum at the heart of politics rather than at the periphery.
One of the things that came to mind while you were talking is this idea on hospitality is how then it's become actually in places criminal to be hospitable, and like what, how messed up that is, basically.
Absolutely. Derrida actually has this rant in one of his texts where he talks about France actually made it a law, this, what they called a crime of hospitality. And there have been people prosecuted that you probably heard of, like Frederic Arroux and people like Carola Rackett and Scott Warren in the United States, who've been prosecuted precisely because they're trying to save people's lives and trying to help people in their quest to seek asylum. There's this terrible paradox and this insane idea of calling hospitality itself criminal.
Yeah.
So my effort, sorry, go on.
No, go ahead.
I was just going to say, so my effort was to sort of move, as I say, move asylum to the center of the political as a concept rather than at the periphery. There's a line in the book where I quote a political theorist, a philosopher called Joseph Cairns, who's very famous for writing a paper calling for open borders, the case for open borders. But he wrote a book in 2013 called The Ethics of Immigration that has a chapter on refugees. And in that chapter, I feel he sort of gives the game away in terms of how political theorists tend to think about the right to asylum and refugees when he refers to asylum as a secondary derivative duty. So what does that mean? So a basic account of politics, of political societies would be that you have a group of individuals in, let's say, a kind of Hobbesian state of nature who form a social contract to create Leviathan, to create the sovereign, to create the state in which they live and can live together, work together and prosper and so on. And then you are faced with the question of the other, of the outsider. And then the question is, what is to be done? Like as David Owen's recent book title puts it, what do we owe to refugees? What do we owe to other people, to outsiders and so on? And I really wanted to turn that inside out or turn it on its head. And say that actually asylum is central to the task of politics from the very beginning. And it's not a secondary derivative duty, but rather it's at the heart of politics. So how can we make that claim? So just to unpack that for a moment. First, if we start with the human subject, I think a basic account of the human subject that's dominant in political theory, political philosophy, would be a sort of standard liberal subject where you have the sort of individual monadic subject, sort of springs up in the world by themselves. Judith Butler has this great thing where she talks about Robinson Crusoe as the sort of figure of the liberal subject who sort of sprang like Athena from Zeus's head without ever having had any real context, any social context. He's just all of a sudden on the island by himself and pursuing his life. And he comes into relation with others, but he's sort of this autonomous figure standing on his own, and that's a sort of basic, that liberal subject is a sort of way we tend to think about political subjectivity, and that we then can form into groups and so on after that, and of course communitarians would have another version of that, but that's basically how political subjectivity is understood. And that's where I use the philosopher Immanuel Levinas to challenge this, to say that the human subject is always already a relational subject. So for Levinas, the selfhood of each of us is in part constituted by our relations with others. In other words, I don't come into the world, simply fully formed as Nathan and then encounter Vanessa. There's a certain sense in which my encounter with you is always already constitutive of myself, like my very, not just my experience in the world, but my actual subjectivity. So selfhood itself has the encounter with the other built into it, as it were. So that's the sort of modality of subjectivity, but it's also a responsible subjectivity in that for Levinas, we are called by what he calls the face of the other to be responsible for other people. So instead of the autonomous liberal subject making simply rational decisions about what responsibilities are for outsiders, in Levinas, you get an account of the subject where you are always already called to responsibility for other people, that to be a human being in the world is to be responsible, or to be called to responsibility, because one can still deny it, but to be called to responsibility for other people. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
Right. So then I marry that up to Hannah Arendt's notion of plurality. So Hannah Arendt has this notion of plurality that she talks about in The Human Condition. There's different ways of understanding what she means by this, and I have my own particular interpretation. But plurality essentially means that we share the world with other people, in terms of not just a plurality of individuals, which is partly what she means, because she talks about it in terms of equality and distinction between different people. But I think it can also be understood to mean a plurality of peoples. And this is a way in which Judith Butler, again, interprets this notion of plurality. My book, by the way, is very much influenced by a book by Judith Butler called Parting Ways, where she talks about the Israel-Palestine conflict in terms of these two peoples who did not choose each other, who are having to live with each other, and that need to find a cohabitation. So in other words, in plurality, there are always groups of people in the world that one did not choose, just as in for Levinas, in one's subjectivity, there are other people that one did not choose. So we are always already in the world with other people and other groups that we did not choose. And so there's a very interesting phrase in the beginning of Arendt's Origins of Totalitarianism, where she talks about the need for human dignity to find a new guarantee that can only be found in a new law on earth, which is a fascinating phrase that I interpretively link in my book to a phrase that's in her last book, The Life of the Mind, the last book she was writing that's incomplete, that she was writing when she died, where she says that plurality is the law of the earth. Now, for Arendt, I don't know that that's an explicitly moral claim. I don't think she necessarily saw it that way. There's some scholarly disagreement about how to interpret Arendt on this. But for me, Arendt is answering her own call in Origins of Totalitarianism that we need a new law on earth and human dignity needs a new guarantee. And the law will supply this guarantee, that plurality itself is the law of the earth. In other words, fundamental to politics itself is the safeguarding of human plurality, that all groups have a right to exist on the earth, and we have a responsibility and an obligation to safeguard those lives. So whether they be people, transiting through Mexico to reach the border of the United States, or whether they are people crossing the Mediterranean to Europe, or whether they are people coming on boats to try and access Australia, just to pick on Western states, because that's who I mostly pick on and have in my sights in this book, that fundamental to politics is this primary duty we have to other people to make all lives livable, as Judith Butler would say, and for lives not to be precarious. So this flies in the face of a typical account of the political, where we attend to our own interests, and as in terms of what you and I were talking about earlier in terms of housing in Sweden and so on, the idea that we simply have primary obligations to our fellow citizens and then we worry secondarily about other people, that this is a false vision of politics, that it attempts to escape or elude the fact that we are in an original relation with other people. We are always sharing the earth with other people, and that we have a moral obligation to safeguard all lives. So at the end of Eichmann in Jerusalem, one of Arendt's charges against Eichmann is that he arrogated to himself the right with whom to inhabit the earth, and that was his crime. His crime was against human plurality as such, that he felt he could say that certain people, groups of people such as the Jewish people, did not have the right to share the earth with him. And that's why Arendt said, we should not be expected to share the earth with you, and that's why you must hang. because he had committed this fundamental crime against the givenness of plurality as such. And that's the same crime that's being committed by states today in refusing to admit people and to safeguard lives.
Yeah, and to talk about the U.S., since that's what I'm most familiar with, because that's where I'm from originally, the border of the U.S. and Mexico. And, you know, when I realized, like, a lot of the people coming through during the Trump administration and always, you know, don't they were having trouble finding translators because people didn't even speak Spanish. They spoke native languages, indigenous languages. And to the realization that many of these people are actually indigenous persons and that this sort of persecution against indigenous people of the Americas is still going on, like, in these ways to this day, is just horrifying.
Absolutely. And it's a real problem, as I understand it, the U.S. border in terms of resourcing, of providing sufficient translators and providing sufficient judges in terms of processing dockets, in terms of people's claims for asylum. Yeah, so that goes to my point, really, in terms of states having to see this as a primary obligation rather than a secondary obligation, that it's not just a burden imposed from without, but one is always living in the world already with other people. The one did not choose. I mean, Martin Luther King has this great phrase in the letter from Birmingham Jail about an inescapable network of mutuality, that we depend upon each other in the world. And, you know, there are various things in the world such as climate change, terrorism, other types of issues, human trafficking and other things one can name, that just show that, you know, the problems we face as a global community cannot be reduced to the absurd historical and racist constructions of the nation state, that we need a new account, a new concept of the political to address this.
Yeah, and of our global responsibility, because as you point out as well, that, you know, that it's going to be more and more that there are people having to migrate because of the climate change and the climate crisis, in addition to, of course, all the wars.
Right. We're even seeing examples now in highly developed societies, you know, when we talk about the developed and the developing world, if I can put it that way, or the global north, the global south, you know, obviously the floods that have just happened in Germany, but also a year and a bit or so ago in Australia in terms of the bushfires. And we actually had our first climate refugees in terms of people being stranded on a beach because the firewall had reached the sort of limits of where they were, that they actually had to be rescued by the Navy. So when I refer to King's notion of our inescapable network of mutuality, there is hopefully a growing recognition that we're all in it together, that we can no longer sort of, you know, the idea of, you know, Trump and his wall, and that we can all sort of just raise our borders and fences and that's going to protect us. It's just nonsense. Yeah, it's not going to work.
And you talk about at the end of your book, the children and the children being separated. And I love this pilgrimage that you took to this place in France where the children had been taken away by train and executed. You know, would you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thanks for asking about that. Yeah, so the coda at the end of the book it's really a misnomer, because a coda in a piece is meant to be a relatively short, you know, addendum to a piece, to a written work or a musical work and so on. But it's actually the longest section of the book. I got a bit carried away with this account of things. Yeah, so I, as you say, I undertook a kind of pilgrimage to this tiny little hamlet in France called Izieu, which was a site of a particular set of events concerning the Shoah, the Holocaust, where this fella Klaus Barbie, who was a Gestapo officer, had rounded up 44 children who all got deported to and perished in Auschwitz. I was sort of moved to do this. I lived in Paris for a year and a half on scholarship while I was writing my thesis. And so I was getting very interested in French politics and history and so on. But I watched a documentary called Hotel Terminus, which goes through the history of Klaus Barbie and his record in France and what he did. He's famous for having tortured Jean Moulin, the head of the French resistance. He tortured him to death. But he also is famous and infamous for this roundup of these children. And it's sort of striking because, as I say, the little hamlet of his you is this tiny little place. It's quite an effort to get there. You know, you've got to take a train from Paris to Lyon, then another train from Lyon to another small village, and then from there a taxi for a long time into the countryside, which sort of to me testified to the absolutism of the sort of murderous drive of the Nazis to hunt down every Jewish person that they could. And even, you know, this group of children. It's just the most horrendously cruel act. And I found that documentary very moving. So I wanted to go there and pay my respects, but as you may recall from reading the chapter, I was struck by how beautiful a place it is. It's just an absolutely gorgeous place. Like Izu is sort of gathered around this crystal blue lake, and you have the Alps in the background and this like glorious countryside. And it was just a reminder of the horror that lurks beneath the everyday. So that led me into a sort of discussion of it took me back to Derrida and thinking about what he calls hauntology. So I tried developing that chapter of politics of hauntology to try to make us remind the reader of what the stakes are of all this in terms of my book's argument, that we're sort of surrounded by ghosts, that we're surrounded by the dead, whether we know it or not. Even in places as lovely as Izu is. And this is true, you know, virtually everywhere. Like there's another line I quote from Hans Blumenberg, who talks about both progress and sinkings leave behind the same calm surface or clear surface. So like the Mediterranean, for example, you know, a boat can sink without trace and everything appears calm and placid, but there's a horror that lurks beneath this. And this is, we have to understand that this is true of all politics today, that state decisions to exclude people or not to actively help, not to engage in what I call an ethos of responsibility, are actually putting people to death. Not only are borders violent constructions, Rhys Jones has a really good book called Violent Borders, Refugees and the Right to Move, where he points out that actually, you know, tens of thousands of people die at a border each year, but also the failure to accept people or the decision to deport people can actually lead to death. And, you know, you were just talking about the US border. There's a book called Deported to Death, which talks about the people who get deported from the United States to the border towns in Mexico, which are some of the most dangerous places on earth. So deportation is tantamount to death at times, or the failure to provide adequate you know, measures in terms of state-funded sea rescue operations on the Mediterranean, for example. So that, you know, we have a false concept and a false image of politics if we only attend to the visible and the apparent and what's, you know, sort of readily obvious to us. We need to be just as attendant to ghosts. And so that was my gesture in terms of going to pay tribute to these children who are disappeared from the earth, which is, you know, not to privilege them in any way above children or adults, people who are suffering today, whether it's, you know, any number of groups from the Palestinians to the Rohingya, you know, people from Sri Lanka. I mean, I shouldn't start naming refugee cohorts because there's just so many. But I try to show in the book how the events of the past, in terms of, as you were saying, for the Shoah and the Second World War, that nothing's really changed, that the behavior of states then is the same as behavior of states now, and that this is just a moral disgrace. And so something, we need a radically new radical new concept of the political to address this. I don't know if you know that there was a film called Transit that came out a couple of years ago, directed by Christian Petzold. Transit's a novel by a German novelist called Anna Seghers, that's set in Marseille in about 1941, where a lot of exiles from Germany are gathered who are trying to get on boats and get out of Europe, basically, and get to the United States. And he makes this really interesting gesture in the film in that he retains the original story, the 1941 story, but he sets it in contemporary Marseille. So you actually, like, the surroundings that you see are relatively modern, but there's this sort of World War II story being unfolded in the present day, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. So there's a kind of mutual implication, a sort of combining of past and present in that film, which is a really fascinating gesture, I think, in terms of showing like this issue that things have not changed in terms of the politics of asylum. And it's a similar kind of gesture I try to make in this book.
Right, and that was the whole point of it becoming international law, that people have the right to seek asylum, was so that people weren't turned away and sent back to their deaths again. And so how do you imagine we could enforce this? Like, we were talking also before we were recording about like the EU and having this be like a value that everyone in the EU supposedly has, but then having it not actually happening in practice.
I mean, that's the million-dollar question. That's the hardest part of this, is just, you know, it simply requires that ongoing struggle. I mean, and there are lots of activists, you know, doing much more than me, like in practical terms, in terms of trying to fight against this sort of racist system. And you know, with my Marxist hat on, there's also a significant, you know, element of capitalism that's involved here in terms of the exploitation of the global South by the global North. You know, you think about the work of someone like Achille Mbembe and his work on necropolitics and the critique of Black reason in terms of accounting for, I think that kind of thinking is vital in accounting for how states behave and why they behave the way they do and why people have the mindset that they do. And then in terms of, you know, changing people's minds, changing people's hearts, you know, that's a very difficult question. But like at my highest aspiration, my goal would be to get people to think about politics in a completely different way, as I was trying to elaborate before, in terms of this relational sort of sense of human identity and experience and the ethical responsibility that's built into that. That's not simply sort of arbitrary or supervenes afterwards, but is always already inscribed within human relations. And if we can start to get people to think about politics that way, rather than in a more sort of, you know, liberal individualistic way, hopefully we can start to engender a kind of more global politics of responsibility and solidarity.
So what are you working on now?
So I'm still writing some different papers on refugees and asylum seekers. So I'm working a little bit on the sort of refugee migrant distinction at the moment. I think one of the cutting edge questions in refugee studies is, to what extent should we distinguish between migrants and refugees? So I'm trying to write a paper about that, because I think that the reasons that people move around the world are quite complex and cannot necessarily be mapped onto this binary. And there's a lot of really interesting work being done on this. I just read a great book called Crossing by Professor Rebecca Hamlin, who sort of deconstructs this binary of the migrant and the refugee. So I think that's a really sort of interesting area of research. So that's one thing I'm working on. Another thing I'm working on is I'm attempting to write a book for a kind of ethical vision for the left. One thing I'm concerned about is, you know, socialism and communism are very much sort of back on the agenda in a big way these days. Not that they ever left, but I think a lot of young people aspire to see a sort of democratic socialist horizon. You know, that the enthusiasm around figures like Bernie Sanders and AOC, and even, you know, further left than that, that you know, young people are enthusiastic about you know, socialism and communism. However, I'm very disturbed by some discussion on the left, especially the sort of further left, about, they don't seem to have learned the lessons of 20th century communism in terms of the recourse to violence, the sort of the aporia of the problem of how do you deal with revolution and counter-revolution. In other words, every time you try to engender a revolution, I mean, if it's important enough, it will always bring about a counter-revolution in opposition to it. So what's to be done with that counter-revolution? Does that require violence and secret police and so on? And how do you prevent that from becoming open-ended? So I'm looking to wrestle with the problem of how we can have an ethical revolution, as it were, from the perspective of Levinas, thinking about what are the sort of limits that should be placed around, you know, a socialist or a communist project, in terms of bringing about a world that's based, that's driven by a sense of human need rather than profit, but which also avoids the pitfalls of some of the excesses we have seen in actual existing communism, in terms of police states, in terms of imprisonment, in terms of repression, and so on. So that it's a big set of questions and rather dangerous waters to wade in terms of, you know, Marxist theory and so on. But that's something I'm looking to tackle next.
Yeah, that's actually something that's been on my mind this specific weekend, because I'm originally from Miami, and there's been this SOS Cuba hashtag going around, and the Cuban people last week, you know, started protesting the government there. And a lot of my friends who I really respect in academia, they've always held up Castro as this sort of figure of like someone who's like stand strong against like U.S. imperialism, which I could see and respect. And actually seeing them post pictures of him as a hero actually made me like have to like research it more and think about it more, because my knee-jerk reaction was like, Castro's a dictator. I'm from Miami. I grew up with all the Cuban people who left. And so I went through like this whole process over the past year of thinking about that and trying to like put in perspective and understand their perspective, because I trust them and I respect them and their work. But now that the Cuban people like are saying they want their freedom, I'm finding that a lot of my academic friends are still on the side of that, like Castro's a hero, and not listening to the people that say that they've been oppressed. And I feel like with all the other kinds of arguments, like with Palestine, we're supposed to listen to the people. So why in this case are we not supposed to listen to the people, but are still like holding on to ideologies?
Right, absolutely. It's quite complicated, really, isn't it? Because I mean, you would know more than me, but the history of Cuba, I mean, in terms of the United States, that, you know, the U.S., you know, infamously used Cuba as a kind of brothel and a casino prior to the revolution. And I think there were great advancements made in terms of the revolution. There's statistics about, you know, literacy. Famously, Cuba has a great health system, certainly punches above its weight in terms of what it achieves. And it's also quite repressive, you know, Castro jailing political prisoners. There's an Oliver Stone documentary that shows him giving people 20 years in jail for simply trying to leave Cuba, trying to immigrate with an E. And also, as I understand, things like LGBT rights were very bad under communism in Cuba and so on. So I think it requires a sort of nuanced conversation where one doesn't simply either support the enemies of, you know, socialism, communism, in terms of just being the useful idiots for imperialism in terms of, you know, the United States and its motivations, but at the same time, not simply parroting the talking points of some repressive dictators who wear the mantle of socialism or communism. The one that's really driving me nuts at the moment is what's happening in Xinjiang in China, and the elements of the left that are denying what's happening there in terms of what very much looks like a cultural genocide, because, you know, they see China, you know, it wears the colors of communism, but it's in no way a communist state. I mean, it certainly brought, you know, hundreds of millions of people out of poverty and so on, but there's a sort of like, it's almost like just as simple as like people are like picking teams. It's a sort of the sort of anti-imperialism of fools, where they're saying like, we're against American imperialism, therefore we're with anyone that's against that. So we're with the Chinese, you know, we're sort of throwing the Uyghurs under the bus. And they like to point to, you know, one or two right-wing researchers who are studying this and criticizing China and saying, look, it's just this right-wing propaganda. When you don't need to do that, you just need to, you know, listen to the voices of Uyghurs in exile, for example, who can testify to what's going on, what happened to them, why they can't speak to their families, and so on. So yeah, I'm very much of the view that we need a more nuanced discussion on the left and not just simply be sort of blind anti-imperialists. So that's one thing I'm sort of wrestling with at the moment.
Yeah, that's great. And yeah, there's this Cuban artist who I really love, who has an image that they just posted like yesterday, that's basically like a person holding up a sign of Che, like a picture of Che, like, yeah. But then behind Che is like somebody beating, like being beaten by the military police, you know.
Right.
So
it is that it is as I was saying before, is that sort of dialectics of revolution, because to overthrow entrenched interests in terms of capitalism, I'm not against violence, you know, for like just for its sake. Like that's not my position just for its sake. Like I can see a necessary sort of violence to overcome a worse violence. You know, Mark Twain has that great line about the terror during the French Revolution filled one cemetery, but there was another terror that lasted millennia that all of France could not contain the graves. In other words, this sort of unending exploitation and oppression of people. To overthrow that, you might need to break a few eggs, as the saying goes, but then how do you limit that violence? And how does it not become open-ended and not just, how does the revolution not become simply the plaything of a sort of vanguardist few who then just hold on to their power? How do we have real democratic socialism?
Yeah, because that's what I think too, like watching a bunch of documentaries and thinking about Castro and that revolution. And like, I think it looks like he had really good intentions and like really wanted the best for the people in the beginning. But then in the end, you know, beloved leaders don't stay in power until they die and then hand over power to their brother. You know, that's what dictators do at the end of the day. So how do you like have the revolution, but then like still make sure it stays of the people and that people don't like get too power hungry? It's really difficult.
Right, exactly. And like having a nuanced conversation in terms of, you know, if you look at, you know, what's going on in Haiti as well and around the region, you know, the United States always, you know, there's always imperial fingerprints on everything that's going on. So, you know, to be able to say both things at once in a way is really quite simple. To be able to say that, yes, United States is a brutal imperial power and we should oppose what it's doing in so many ways, but also to point out the injustices that occur that come from other centers of power.
Yeah,
it seems to be beyond the grasp of a lot of people on the left. It's similar in a way to the debate between Camus and Sartre, you know, back in the day where they were sort of arguing about the Soviet Union. And while Camus was not a stronger thinker, I think morally he was more on the right track in saying, look, we should be denouncing the gulags in the Soviet Union just as we denounce the injustices and the colonialism of the West. And, you know, Sartre was being a bit more, you know, he said outrageous things. Like he said, writers in the Soviet Union are the freest writers in the world. He was telling these lies because he said, we don't want to drive Billancourt to despair. We don't want to discourage people who are for communism. But I think we need to have a more honest conversation about the left and what our aim should be and why.
Yeah, that's a good point too, because I really love the psychoanalyst Sabina Spielrein, who, you know, was a student of Jung and Freud, and the whole Dangerous Method movie was about her. But really sensationalized film. But anyway, I love her and I love her writing. And she went back, she's from Russia originally and went back to Moscow in 1923. And her whole family, like she ended up being executed in World War II, and her daughters, but like her brothers and her father, like they were doctors and professors, and they were all executed as well in this like attempt to like get rid of the bourgeoisie, you know, like you're not supposed to have people in this like intellectual level, and we don't want that. We want all of our thinkers, we want our academics, you know.
Right. Just on that, back to the refugee question, it's interesting you say that. In the recent Adam Curtis documentary, the most recent one, is called Can't Get You Out of My Head. Did you get a chance to see that at all? Mm-mm. Okay, really great documentary. There's a section in the beginning of one of those, one of the episodes, where he talks about the response on the left to refugees from Vietnam in 1975 and after, where a lot of what you would call, I suppose, petite bourgeois people were fleeing Vietnam because they feared, you know, communist reprisal. And there was a kind of antipathy from some elements of the left to those refugees, is not really seeing them as worthy victims. You know, Noam Chomsky has this language of worthy and unworthy victims, where, you know, again, like a US, an imperial power like the United States, they'll focus on some victims in the world when it suits their political purpose, but the ones where it doesn't suit their purpose or where they're complicit, as in, say, Indonesia, for example, in the 60s, where they backed the, you know, slaughter of 500,000 communists. Those are unworthy victims and not worth sort of talking about. I think the same can be true on the left at times. For example, the case of these, refugees from Vietnam, where, the documentary shows this funny sort of tete-a-tete that happened between Joan Baez and Jane Fonda, where Joan Baez was very concerned with the plight of these refugees, but Jane Fonda refused to sign a petition calling for support and aid for these people. And I've done a little bit of reading about in the literature at the time, and there was this sort of reluctance to acknowledge the needs of these people. So when you say, as you say, like, sometimes the so-called bourgeoisie can be victims as well. We think about, Jewish families from Europe in the 30s and 40s. So it's far too simplistic to make one's, sort of moral alignments along the lines of simply of class in that way. So one of my gestures in the book is to say that politics itself equals asylum. And what that does is to give me a sort of what Edward Said might call a contrapuntal perspective, like seeing things from two different places at once, where one can view politics, whether it's from capitalist states or ostensibly socialist states, from the lens of asylum and make judgments on that basis, rather than simply filtering one's judgments through a pre-existing sort of liberal or socialist lens. There's actually the asylum forming the basis of politics itself gives one a means of adjudicating these things. So regardless of who the sort of people are who are, fighting for their, right to belong or who require assistance and so on, that we can then make, form some judgments, regardless of, what type of society we're dealing with.
And
does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. And also using Miami as an example, since that's my home, what happened in Florida and Miami is that, if a person fleeing Cuba because of American politics and their point of view and imperialistic stance, if a person fleeing Cuba arrives on the shores, like even really outside of Florida and doesn't touch the land, they could still be rescued and brought in and stay in the United States. But if a person from Haiti, even if they make land, I have friends from Haiti that family had been there and that my friends had been there for 20 years, and they were still terrified of being sent back because there was like no way for them to be able to seek asylum or be able to stay, because they're just like systematically just always sent back. And that's obviously a very huge racial line as well that's happening. Like Cuban people are allowed to stay and Haitian people have to go back. And it's horrible.
Absolutely. Yeah, I understand they're trying to deport people who are already in the United States now who aren't even simply recent arrivals. They're trying to kick people out.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I had friends in Haiti. I dated a guy from Haiti when I was like 22. And he was born in the States and grew up in there, but he was always terrified of being sent back because it had happened to people in his family. And talk about the political system there and the dictators and horrible things he used to tell me about military people coming into the houses and like saying like, I'm going to shoot you, to the father or the brother, like rape your sister, rape your daughter. I mean, like really, really horrible abuse.
Right. Horrific. Again, a lot of those dictators were backed up by the United States. So again, there's sort of imperial fingerprints on a lot of that. And yeah, I mean, I'm more and more fascinated by the history of Haiti in terms of, obviously the first successful slave revolt and the way it's been punished by, the global north, by Western powers ever since, up until this day. But yeah, the backing of dictators and just the horrendous suffering of people there. Again, that's a conversation that requires nuance, where one recognizes the issues within the society, and there are also very complex differences between groups of Haitians. I was actually just listening to a podcast on this. There's a podcast called This Is Revolution, which actually has a gentleman from Haiti who gives a really excellent breakdown of issues that are going on there. So I recommend that to people if they're interested in finding out more about Haiti. This Is Revolution podcast.
I will link to that. Yeah, and the other thing that I saw lately, because of course Greta Thunberg is the national treasure here, world treasure, international treasure, hopefully. But anyway, she recently said that you know, she pointed out that you know, we act like all of these things are impossible. It's too much. It's too hard to deal with climate change and deal with all these issues. But what coronavirus showed was that actually we did shut everything down. Like, we shut everything down pretty globally, like pretty well, to deal with the pandemic enough, you know, and hopefully we'll still continue to do that. even though America's decided the pandemic's over, whatever. The United States of America, not all of America. Yeah, so she pointed out that we actually do have the ability to kind of shut things down and do things differently if we're really faced with a crisis like the coronavirus. And that, you know, if we actually treated the environment, for example, as a crisis that it is, that we could actually make big changes to deal with it. But sadly, everyone seems to be going, oh, great, let's go back to how it was before Corona, instead of actually being like, remember the beginning when all the cars had stopped and people were like, look, the smog is clearing and we could see the mountains and the animals. Like, does everyone remember that? And like, why don't we do things to like help the earth and help ourselves and help each other?
It comes back to that problem we were sort of discussing at the beginning of how we can get people's minds to change. And that requires this rethinking of politics at a more fundamental level in terms of, yeah, exactly as you say, that requires a sort of mobilization on the order of like the Second World War, where the whole society and international community is geared towards this sort of shared goal that's an existential goal. It's actually about our basic survival and flourishing on the earth. So yeah, I don't know if you saw that great photo. It was going around on Twitter. There was a BMW that had FU Greta written on it, and it was underwater in the flood.
Oh wow.
It was an incredible, incredibly wonderful, you know, poetic justice.
Yeah, exactly. That's your point. Yeah, no, and it's so depressing to see like the amount of vitriol that's been like thrown at her, and you know, it's like, it's amazing that adults can act that way towards anyone, including a teenager, you know, a young person. It's mind-boggling. Is there anything else you wanted to talk about that you didn't get to?
I think we've covered quite a lot. It's been nice chatting. I guess I should mention that people could get my book as an ebook at the moment if they want. Yes. It's available as a hardcover. Yeah, that's a little on the expensive side. That's sort of university libraries type thing, but I'm glad you've got a copy. But yeah, if people want to get it now, they could probably get an ebook. It's a bit more affordable. And also there's going to be a paperback a little bit further down the line in a few months.
Oh, cool. And we will link to all of that. Is there anywhere that people can find you if they want to follow your work?
I have an academia.edu page where people can find my academic work. And I'm on Twitter, but I don't use Twitter all that much. You can find me. It's Nathan_Bell1010. Yeah, so people want to follow me there, they can.
Okay, so I will link to all of these things. So thank you so much for being here and for doing this important work and having these difficult conversations and looking at everything in such a nuanced and thoughtful way.
Thank you for having me, Vanessa. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you for listening to Rendering Unconscious. You've just heard a discussion with Dr. Nathan Bell, professor at the University of Melbourne. His book, Refugees: Towards a Politics of Responsibility, is available as a book and ebook from Roman and Littlefield. Links to everything can be found in the text accompanying this episode. Rendering Unconscious is also a book, Rendering Unconscious, Psychoanalytic Perspectives, Politics, and Poetry, available from Trapart Books, 2019. For more, please visit our publisher's website, trapart.net. That's TRAPART.net. For more information, you can visit my website, drvanessasinclair.net, and sign up for my newsletter on the contact page to stay abreast of all upcoming events. You can also visit the Rendering Unconscious main website, renderingunconscious.org. And follow me at Instagram and Twitter at @rawsin_. That's @rawsin_. Thank you so much for listening to Rendering Unconscious podcast and for your support. You can support the podcast at our Patreon. That's patreon.com/Vanessa23Carl. Your support is so appreciated. Thank you so much to all of our Patreon patrons.
I'll choose my opinion, 'cause I didn't want to make other humans. I know Briar Bjorge, and I said, champion the idea of thee today. You woke up in a disgruntled mood, creation to occur. It is the space as delayed, so you're feeling a bit out of sorts. Experimentation. Rituals create or are daydreaming of sexual fantasies. Encourages mastery through the scene. Remain the same. There are countless. They require less. These differences that a cut is made, it is in. You begin to pay attention and take notice of a lot of women. Well, one could say that all of life is a cut up. How the female body is sacred, a fine core, and one reach, a longer leash. One can see this more of my own, of such spaces across cultures and spiritual. Don't need to make the burning of resins or herbs, the quality of creativity that way, the first rays of morning, the last of, and I will choose to, humming, movement, and ecstatic dance are to point things out. Why so many different? Now let's return to the idea of the fragments.